So give me an A.
Okay.
Give me an A.
I hope this is good.
Hello, everybody. Welcome back. We'll get started with one of those. So I have Mr. Know Your Gear, Philip McKnight, here with me.
What's up?
How's it going? How you doing?
Good, man. I haven't seen you since...
Since like 5 minutes ago.
Yeah.
By the tent.
Since breakfast.
So we're at Tomen Gearhead University, 2019, TGU19, and I was talking to Philip, and I said, let's do a fun video where we could take the Fender Mustang, this is the Mustang GT100, right?
Yep.
12-inch speaker, and compare it to a Fender amp, this one over here. Oh, there we go, okay. And compare it to the real thing, right? So this is the Deluxe Reverb, 65 Deluxe Reverb. Now, of course, this is a modeling amp, this is a tube amp, but what we did was, just for the sake of science, we picked the correct model. That's the 65 Deluxe Reverb. You don't see it in there, but that actually is a 65 Deluxe Reverb. And we're going to just have some fun, and we're going to kick it off by, you know, I set everything at noon except the reverb, because the reverb is very lush. Yeah. So the reverb is on at about 2 for both of them. And let's take... A sound sample of this, a sound sample of this. Do they stack up? Does this sound like the real thing? And then we'll talk about feel and some other stuff. So that's the goal of this video. Sound like a plan?
Sounds good to me. Let's
All right.
Do it.
All right.
Especially this. That's one of my favorite amps.
Yep.
So like Fender to me is like Princeton, Deluxe, and the Bass 59.
Mm-hmm.
Those are three. But so it'd be interesting to see when the model of this, how much I enjoy it, considering I like that amp.
Yeah, right.
I think sometimes when we model amps that you're familiar with, that's cool, but when you have a passion for an amp,
right.
I'm curious to see if I...
So we picked a good amp.
Oh yeah, right? I think so.
And I think one of the problems with modeling in general is someone gets a modeling unit and there's 100 amps and like, oh cool, that's... But they don't really have a frame of reference of how does the real amp sound.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Trying to nail one tone
right.
really well.
Yep. All right, so with that said, we are hooked up right now into the 65 Deluxe Reverb. Let's give us some tones, and then we'll switch to the Mustang.
So we're going to use a humbucker for the bridge, and then we'll do the single coil, right?
Okay.
Hold on, we might be out of tune.
But... That is loud. By the way, if I'm like, look like I just had sour lemonade, it's just, this volume is really loud in here.
It's ear-piercing. Ear-piercing. Here we go.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. So
For reference, let's do the single coil real quick, too.
Okay.
Yeah, why not? Because that's the humbucker. That's going to drive the amp much differently than...
Yep, you know, okay. Right? Let's do the single.
Wow, it's a lot. It's really... It's so bassy, it's hard to find that
spot. And we'll find...
Okay.
Okay. So now let's come over here. Basically, all the controls at noon. Reverb is at about, you know, just a little bit, one or two.
And this is something to point out. We should point out again. We're loud. So this isn't like in the low frame. This is the amp's desired, you know, volume.
Yeah.
So this is going to be a fair fight to see how much the Mustang can
control. Right.
Here we go.
This is not at bedroom volume.
Yeah, this is not bedroom volume. Where actually, I bet you, all right, we'll see.
Do that again.
Okay, here we go.
Okay, so let's go back again, and then I'll share with you my thoughts.
Okay, here we go.
My thoughts are this has a lot more body to it.
I absolutely hate that. Because I can tell you right now, I actually, I bet you if we listen to the playback, you could hear how I took just an extra almost second to finally hit the G, because I didn't want to rake the last three high strings, because it just sounds like I'm kicking a glass window
right.
when I did that. So I love, and I actually liked that.
Right.
That felt like rock and roll to me.
Mm-hmm.
Like it was breathing.
Well, this had body and life. This was a little, it sounded boxy.
Yeah. You know what it sounded like? It sounded like a facsimile of what that sounded like.
I guess a model. It's a modeling amp, so it's a model.
Yeah, but in the interesting way that it was, yes, if you asked me if this sounded like that, yeah, it sounds like that. But does it feel like that? Did it rumble the room like that? Did it have the
right.
depth and fullness, the body that
right.
you said? That's where it failed. Like I said, I'm sure if we turn them down to volume one of each, it would be...
You know, it's interesting. You brought up an interesting point. This being that this is the real thing, it's almost three-dimensional, right?
Right.
This is a picture of that. So it's a very two-dimensional
right.
version of this.
Would you
agree with that?
Based on what I'm hearing, that's absolutely...
You mind if I give this a quick
please,
go?
Please.
Okay.
Can you pick?
Yeah, thank you. So we are in the Mustang right now. Up here, it's a little shrill.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, we're in the deluxe reverb. It's a night and day difference.
Yeah, but I hate...
You hate what?
No. I still like that one. I was going to say, maybe I don't like them both, but actually, that feels, fuller. Try this again.
Got life to it. It's just got body and life.
Yes.
Okay, one more time. It's like you said, it's a facsimile.
This is what I picture in the future when they try to simulate what meat tastes like. It's gonna happen. Yeah, some kind of man-made. like, you'll be eating and go, I mean, yeah, it's kind of like what steak tastes like, but it's all wrong. You know what I mean?
Right.
And I mean, it's hard. I feel like I'm being so harsh. I mean, it is, what, $300 versus $1,100?
Right.
I mean, that's a huge difference. This is a lot lighter. It's got 1,000 other options to it. And, okay, so what we should do now is now we did... The, like you said, what did you call it how you set up the amps? What were you saying?
Everything was at noon.
Okay, noon. Here's what I think we should do now.
Mm-hmm.
Why don't we, I love the deluxe reverb,
mm-hmm.
so why don't we dial in the setting I use, which is a real common setting on the amp,
mm-hmm.
and I'm really curious to see what happens if we try to mimic that setting on this amp.
Let's do it.
Because the deluxe reverb, if you can get a shot of the deluxe reverb, deluxe reverb, I'm going to reach across real quick.
Yep.
Is there's a thing called so funny called the bass dump where you take like a Princeton and a deluxe reverb and you turn the bass tone with zero or maybe one or two,
mm-hmm.
and juice the tremolo to six or seven, right?
Mm-hmm.
Very unintuitive, right? I mean, just nowhere in your mind do you think that. Essentially, in this amp, these amps, the mid range is set already. That's why there's no mid range control, it's
mm-hmm.
already kind of put where it needs to be. This amp found its magic in that setting, in the idea that the bass player is going to take care of all the frequencies
right.
that you need in that area. The drummer will be in the high frequencies, the bass player will be, so that's what it's known for, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious to see when they modeled it, did mm-hmm. they consider that players like me that use that amp a lot will
do it.
Will do that setting.
Let's do the same thing here. So what did you bring the treble down to? Okay. You brought it up to about 7.
Yep.
We have the keying on, right? Okay. Yep. So that's probably at about 7. And you dumped the bass to what, about 1 or 2?
1 or 2. And we can match it up. It's right now it's on
it's about
2. So it's on 2. You can.
There's no 1 or 2 here.
Yeah. Already, here's an issue. Why no numbers? Such a typical Fender design.
Well, if you click here.
Yeah. Does it give you the number? Oh, look, it does. Wait, is that the preset?
Let's go back to treble. No, there's no. I see it spinning.
Yeah.
But I don't see the number.
Interesting to me because, a number is such a such a useful tool when dialing in an amplifier.
Well,
right?
Well, let's assume that's 0.
Sure.
So that's 1. That's 2.
Sure.
Okay. Treble, if that's 10, 9, 8, 7.
Sure.
Let's assume. Best.
Okay. Let's start with the deluxe, though.
Okay.
Let's start with the
Okay.
The magic palette, I guess. Even though before it was really bassy, mm-hmm. Fender amps by nature are bassy. It's
right.
Weird to me. I'm sure the internet would love to argue it. Go ahead and start the comments going now.
Yep.
I have always felt that Fender amps are a bassy amplifier.
Right.
Not compared to what a metal player would consider a bassy mm-hmm. amplifier. I can mm-hmm. understand why it's not going to be a 412.
Right.
But to me, that's why it's. I think people are so instinctively kind of just want to jack those knobs
mm-hmm.
up.
Mm-hmm.
The whole Marshall roll the knobs
yep.
is not the Fender
right.
deal. You know, only maybe on the Bass 59, which too is a totally different circuit than
mm-hmm,
this.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm curious, you heard it because, we were talking earlier about this. So how did you like this sound compared to the sound when it had the bass control?
When you had the bass, it was very rumbly.
Yeah, kind of flubby.
Yeah, a little flubby, yeah. Bad, though.
No, not bad.
Full.
It
but
was
maybe
great.
Too full for a band.
Yes, and also, it's a little hard to control. Cause
right.
Yeah, and so this feels tighter. Yep. I feel like, it's more percussive.
So give me an A.
Okay.
Give me an A.
I hope this is good. We might have broke it. It sounds like it. I know. Wow.
That didn't sound good.
That is not.
One more time. You ready? Hold on. Give me an A. There we go. Give me an A.
Now, it's probably a good time to mention a couple things. Because somebody out there has a Mustang. And they've learned everything about it, and they're versed in it, and they're probably typing right now how we're doing it all wrong.
Right.
And please consider, this is first impressions for us.
Right? Yeah, because we're definitely not a pro on this amp.
Yeah, we're looking at it like, if I walked up on a stage to jam real quick, that's how I would dial in that amp, mm-hmm. or Princeton real fast, which I think is very common for players that own those amps. I think a mm-hmm. lot of people out there right now that own these amps and use them are right now nodding when I was talking earlier, like, oh yeah, I run it that way a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And so instinctively you want to run it this way. Something I was thinking about when I was playing just now, looking at it, what's weird about this is this has a gain control and that amp doesn't have a gain control. So the question now is that, so if we were saying these knobs are all lined up with that amp,
mm-hmm.
that knob can't be because that knob doesn't exist on that amp.
Well, the reason why I set this at noon, all things being equal, if every control is on noon across two Fender products,
right.
you want to assume
That you're getting flat response.
You're getting a flat response.
Right. So,
but let's try it.
Yeah, mess with that knob.
Give me some.
Yeah. That's a lifeless, but actually less shrill.
It definitely sucks some life out of it, though.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Put it a quarter turn back, right there. It is so bad. It's just, it's weird to me, because it's not the same. We're in the room. I'm feeling the room sound. How about you?
Right.
And I'm not saying bad like it's a bad quality amplifier. But
well, here's the thing. We are comparing it to this.
Yeah, the real
as
deal.
As a standalone amp.
Right.
And you're jamming with some friends. Maybe it's fine. It's a guitar amplifier. It amplifies the sound of the guitar.
Yeah.
Fine.
Yeah. Right.
But compared to the real thing, I think it failed the test.
Yeah. And to be fair, and I'm just being fair to the Fender guys, if it didn't fail, I think that would be the extremely shocking thing. I mean, it would be, actually, think of this. If it even got close, it would really make that look silly.
So let's have fun now.
Okay.
Let me hear this again, and let me try to EQ this to match
sure,
it.
Sure, sure. Let's
all
do
right,
it.
So let's do this. Give me a...
Give me an A.
Give me an A.
See, that feels like rock and roll to
it
me.
It does. Okay. Give me an A. Do it again. One more time. One more time. Go ahead. Closer. We got closer.
You know what it is? I know what it is that's bugging me and why I keep saying, oh, it sounds horrible. It sounds like this amp
sounds like it's in a cone.
Right.
That's what I'm hearing. At first, I couldn't figure out. You said kind of
boxy.
Boxy. That's what I agree with you. It's in a cone.
Right.
Right.
Like, right.
And that sound, it's not that the sound itself is so bad. It's that cone sound is really throwing playing off.
Right.
Like,
yep.
I
do think we got it a little closer.
Oh, yeah. And like I said, and what's tricky now, and we can't undo this. We can't do it. What would we have thought if we didn't A/B it? You know what I mean? I think most players, I think this is a really good point, and your point actually, which is without the reference of the real deal,
mm-hmm.
would you come to this conclusion right now?
Well, I think that's the problem in general when you have any modeling amp.
Right.
Is how many people are comparing it to the real thing.
Yeah.
So if we didn't have the deluxe reverb here, maybe someone would say, no, it's pretty cool. Let's stick with that.
Well, that's
okay. And a lot of times people that get the sample just go through the dial and say, okay, that tone works for me.
Right.
They're not necessarily doing what we're doing. They're just scrolling through this knob here to find something that works for them in that situation.
And we don't know how much time they devoted to developing this particular patch. Fender being obviously the global kind of winner of amp sales.
Mm-hmm.
is smart enough to know what the market is for this amp. And knowing that, they could have probably dialed in the sounds for that particular market,
mm-hmm.
right? So if they know the average Mustang player is a heavy rock, light metal,
right.
metal dude, the same thing, these presets might be all dialed in. And then these are the afterthought presets that are there for the, you know, people to have. But.
Do you remember Underoos?
Yeah.
You remember that?
Yeah.
This is the Underoos.
This
it's not the real thing.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying, though?
Oh, yeah.
Like when you have a kid dress up like the Hulk.
Right. And
no one's beating that kid up saying, hey, that's not the real Hulk. It's
right.
It's a copy.
Right.
So this is a copy.
Yeah. It's the Underoos of amplifiers.
Was that bad?
I just feel like there's a 19-year-old kid right now just Googling Underoos. For those of you who may not know, Underoos was a thing that went away. Actually, they probably still have them. Anyways, Underoos was costumes, but it was literally like whitey tidies, but they would color them and then give you like a wife beater type shirt.
So you're like Captain America.
Yeah,
the
so that when you were a little kid and you go to bed, you could go to bed as a superhero. And then sometimes you would take them outside if you were crazy enough, right? Because Like, you know, some kids would wear them for costumes at Halloween. Right. Put a towel.
Remember I'm crying, I'm laughing so hard.
Put a red kitchen towel around your neck and your underoos.
Right.
And, so that's what he means, is that it's a far cry from the real thing. Another thing to point out, too, for anybody, you know, because let's face it, somebody watching this might be actually looking at these. Mm-hmm. I'm going to tell you right now that if you're taking this on stage and the other guitar player has that, you might as well not even show up.
Yeah.
You just sit in the audience and watch. There's no way when these are cranked. Well, this was going to cut over that.
That's probably a good way to wrap this video up, is with some advice, and we've heard this before. If you're in a gig, bring the best gear you have, right?
Oh, that's good. I've never even heard that.
Yeah. You want to show up with a good guitar, something that stays in tune, something that's reliable, something you know your way around, an amp that could keep up, something that's... And this is a great example. At a high volume, it's shrill. And if you think it's shrill, the whole band's going to think it's shrill.
Yeah.
So just something that's, you know... reliable, something that sounds good, something that could keep up in a band, something you know your way around. It's probably a good little tip to leave you all off with. So, with that said, anything else you want to share, or should we wrap it up?
No, man, that was a blast.
All right, so TGU 19, Phil, thanks so much for participating in this Fender shootout video. We'll leave you all off with one of those. We'll see you later.